Mike, give me your big takeaway. When we had, you know, on one hand, we had all of this information that came through today, headlines that you would think would be calming the market.
Yeah, exactly, Contessa. I mean, you had a jobs report that seemed like it was right in the zone that the market would have preferred, mildly below forecast, which meant that, yes, the economy is still growing, jobs are still being added, but at a slower pace, giving the Fed cover to ease up a little bit. This is just the latest, a very long line of things you would have thought could be a bullish catalyst that the market has just sneezed at, right? So it was buyback window opens up in October, the midterm elections, you had all, you know, the tariff truce, even the Fed's Powell walk back. So the market itself is in a stressed state, trying to price in a slowdown, not sure if the Fed's going to be friend or foe in that process, and also just a bunch of technical damage. So another visit to the lows.
Your note here said anxious, whippy, suggestible, irresolute. I was wondering if you were getting out your thesaurus in order to come up with words to describe
At one point, I probably did, but I've been doing it long enough that I just kind of go back to what I wrote about things in previous market corrections.
Tony, sum up for us your take on what that jobs print means for the yield curve, for the dollar, for Fed expectations.
Not much, because markets are worried about other things. They're worried about three factors that will probably dominate the calendar in the first few months of the year. These are three big overriding forces. One, of course, is Brexit. Secondly, Italy and its budget. And, of course, U.S.-China trade relations. Macroeconomic information isn't as important now as these things. So it does show how markets can be quite disrupted by factors other than these underlying variables, which have been driving markets for a while. And so until there's a resolution on these things, one could consider them what are called Knightian uncertainties. A Knightian uncertainty, named after Frank Knight from a book he wrote in 1921, is when investors can't measure the risks involved. It's different than an insurance company, for example, that can measure to some extent the amount of car accidents that occur in a day. There are ordinary uncertainties and there are Knightian uncertainties. These have the potential to become Knightian ones, and markets are quite concerned about that.
Jim, are you surprised by the market negativity today on the back of, as Mike was saying, what should have been good news for equities and indeed some other good news over the last 10 days or so for equities?
It is a little surprising given the nice reversal that we had yesterday. That was a pretty pleasant reversal yesterday. But look, nothing has been decided technically in this market. We're testing the lows. We've done that for a few days now. We still haven't broken convincingly above the 200-day moving average for any of the indices on the upside. So nothing's really been decided technically. And then you get the stochastic nature of the Fed governors and the speeches that they give. You give Larry Kudlow saying one thing, and you have Peter Navarro saying the other thing. You have a random nature of what we're getting out of the administration. So nobody knows how to game anything here. I think what's important, though, is investors have to try to decide whether this is the beginning of a bear market or a correction within a bull market. And consumption is still on the rise in the U.S. Consumers are spending more money. That is not the nature of a recession. We have leading and economic and coincident economic indicators still trending north. You don't go into recessions with these things happening. And if we're not in a recession and we're not in a war, it's very unlikely this is the beginning of a bear market. Finally, I want to point out that late stage cycle stock markets do pretty well usually. Prior to the end of the economic cycle, your average return the previous year is about 12%. A lot of people are worried about that late stage cycle, worried about the inverted yield curve, but the market actually does pretty well after the yield curve inverts as well. So I think the market's going to be okay. We just have to get rid of some of the uncertainty. We had the pomp and circumstance of the Trump and Xi meeting, and yet we still don't have any clarity post to that meeting. So too much uncertainty. Market hates uncertainty more than anything else, but likely not the start of a bear market, likely a correction within the context of a bull market.
Lachman, you're taking that penny and you're looking at it from a different angle.
Yeah, of course, from a cyclical perspective, the story is actually totally flipped on its head. We have a cyclical downturn in growth that's been stealth in the beginning of the year, and now it's becoming more noticeable. And I think the market and even the Fed yesterday blinked, and they're noticing this happening. Also, you have the cyclical downturn in inflation. That has implications for profits growth, for example. And those things happen before the trade tensions, all these other things that are popping up, what's coming out of the White House, what's going on with the stochastic Fed, whatever. All of those things are jittery, but they're coming after. It's a 1-2 punch. The first punch is the cyclical slowdown in growth and inflation. Also abroad, by the way, Canada growth is negative, Japan, Germany, Italy, Sweden, Switzerland, even Russia, I think right now. There's a lot of happiness about OPEC maybe cutting supply or whatever. Not a lot of people know Russia's in recession right now. So I don't know how long they're going to be able to hold any supply cuts, for example. So all of this is happening, and then you're having these anxious moments, Brexit, Italy, the Fed, whatever, White House. And those are negative punches. And I think the question now is, what's the next punch? Mm-hmm. We've had two. And what comes next?
Mike, how long forward does the market look when it's considering if there's going to be an economic slowdown? Are we talking 2021, in which case everything's on the table, or are we talking 2019, in which case it'd take a lot to put us into a negative growth environment in the U.S. in 2019?
I think somewhere in the next 2 to 3 quarters is what the market is really trying to surmise. And I think the next 2 to 3 quarters of corporate earnings, right? So, yes, slowdown would feed into that and all the rest of it. So I still think it's about repricing a slower growth rate at this point. And really, to a similar point, I think all the good news was in front of us for most of this year, and it fed two rallies to all-time highs that peak profit levels could not hold, that low yields could not hold. So I think that's the fix we're in, is the psychology of, if that wasn't good enough, what happens in a slowdown, and have we properly discounted stocks enough at this point, with half of all stocks down 20%, by the way, to account for that? Maybe we have, maybe we haven't. That's the ugly process we're seeing day to day play out.